they deal with it. But I never heard that from them. But some people don't seem to want this to happen. Anyway, I'm still quite keen for an organisation like the Russell Foundation and the Tribunal to take it on board. Because I feel that without some kind of strategy, we'll be languishing in arguments with the various powers that be.
Powers that were, they're crumbling. They're coming to an end.
By all means, interrupt it, because I'm not sure. I also gave a paper of service outlining what I thought strategies could involve. And I was bamboozled by the Jewish Chronicle afterwards for suggesting that the Palestinians should have a defence force. Well, in my view, I still hold to the view that a community that's so obviously targeted by a massive army and what they call a defence force, conducting totally unwarranted attacks on totally undefended civilians, must need a defence force, if anyone does.
It's actually a right, isn't it, for the people to defend themselves?
In which forum are you talking about? The United Nations Charter?
Yes.
Possibly. I haven't really discovered that. But it's possibly right. Yeah. It certainly isn't right under the Charter for an occupying power to attack the occupied people. It's just the opposite. The occupied people have a right to resist.
Yes.
And even to resist with appropriate military force. So it's not against the grain of international law to suggest that the Palestinians should have a defence force. I also suggested that they should have a much more, it's rather perhaps forward of me to say this, because I don't really know what sort of deals the Palestinian Authority PNA deal do have with the great powers. But it strikes me that the Chinese, for example, are now very shortly going to be the biggest power on the planet, financially, if not in terms of population, as a united
And they've always got the biggest army in the world.
Indeed, you're right. And they don't spend as much per head as the Americans do even now. Anyway, the point is that the Palestinians need a member of the Security Council, which has got the kind of clout that the Chinese have. And so, again, at another meeting, this was in the Institute of International, the Royal United Services Institute in Whitehall, I asked the then Defense Secretary, who this was a meeting about Palestine, I said, what are we doing to help the Palestinians against the Israeli Defence Force, and he mumbled or offered some meaningless reply. But the point is that after this conference, the Chinese military attaché came up to me and said, would you like to come to lunch? And they've been inviting me to lunch ever since. And they did. Quite apart from the fact that they can't do very much or haven't done very much, they do listen to what I'm saying about the need for a big power like that to put forward, and I've suggested a number of resolutions for them to put forward at the UN Security Council on behalf of Palestine. They haven't done, but they have to be careful. They've got their own human rights, they've got accusations about their own human rights record. It's questionable whether it's justified, but you can see the media building up another one in Hong Kong at the moment. I think that's going to lead to another chairman's experiment for him, and we'll be back in the doghouse. But by putting them in that doghouse, they'll be able to turn around and say, but you're committing human rights by supporting the Israelis against the Palestinians. That's a human rights tragedy. You can't get Gaza. What's just happened in Gaza, it's not the first time, it's about the third time. And in the meantime, they've been shelling the garden as well. So, and of course, as everybody probably knows here, I don't need to recite the fact that they're embargoed, they can't trade easily, some of their trade is falsified, and then you look at it instead, and it's actually Israeli trade.
I think it's going to be like an opportunity for lots of people to share, rather than just you sort of...
Oh, I'm so sorry.
I'm going to wrap up.
No, I'm not.